telling the Ephesians how awesome they are to God. And it's a bit odd because Paul doesn't spend that much time telling others the letters that he wrote. He doesn't spend that much time about how good they look. But in Ephesians, he tells them how blessed they are and how they're redeemed and how they're predestined inheritors of a great gift and that God has given them a guarantee of salvation through the Holy Spirit that he has placed in their hearts. So why would Paul spend all of that time in the first chapter of Ephesians telling the Ephesians how wonderful they are? Well, somebody had apparently been telling them that they weren't valuable to God, that they weren't as valuable to God as they had first thought. Somebody came in and caused them to doubt that they were pretty, that they were awesome. At least as far as I can tell, this congregation was unique because the Ephesian church was entirely Gentile, and there wasn't any Jew amongst them as far as I can see in the scripture. Paul had planted this church years earlier, almost 2,000 years ago. Paul planted this church on a missionary journey in that area, and then came along some people who created doubt, or who caused some doubt in this church. And these Christians that came, pretend Christians that came, told them that there's some things they had to do in order for their baptism to count, or in order for them to be worthy of what Christ has given us. They said that you have to be circumcised first. You've got to become Jews first before you will be valuable to God. And so this first chapter of Ephesians, the entire chapter is dedicated to telling the Ephesians that those false teachers lied, that what they said isn't true, that God sees you much more valuable than that. And he says that you're actually predestined by God to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ according to his will. It was part of God's plan from the beginning of time to include Gentiles in salvation. And these Christians in Ephesus were amongst the first people to experience this prize. And they primed the pump to show that God meant exactly what he had planned to do in accepting them into his family. Now later in this letter, Paul told them that they were living proof. They were living proof of a mystery. And the mystery was that the Gentiles who had been baptized into Christ were acceptable to God just the way they are. In verse 6 of Ephesians chapter 3, it says, this mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Under the Old Testament, the Gentiles were not acceptable to God. They would have not been acceptable to God, but now that Jesus has shed his blood, now that Jesus has come and was sacrificed, these people were now covered with this blood and looked attractive and looked presentable in God's sight. Now that's interesting theology, isn't it? But what does it really mean? Why is that important to us? The first thing right off the bat is that we're all Gentiles. So it's very important to us that God opened the doors for Gentile people to be saved, that he accepts the Gentile people. But then, if we look at it a little more closely, when we look in the mirror, we don't always like what we see. And the things that we see that no one else sees it's the sinful nature. It's the stuff that goes on behind closed doors. It's the things that are in our heart that we're ashamed of. Whenever we look in the mirror and we see those things, we don't like it. And there's so many people in the world that they don't feel worthy. They don't feel like they can be loved by God. God is too good, and we're just too bad. So how can he love someone like me? And Paul tells us, just like he spent an entire chapter telling the Ephesians 2,000 years ago, he says, don't let these people play on your doubts and on your fears, because I want you to know who you are. You are loved, and you are valuable, and you are a child of God. Know who you are.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. Haunted by ghosts that lived in my past. Bound up in shackles of all my failures. Wondering how long is this gonna last? Then you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight.
Nostalgia reasons. And I can only imagine how bad this guy was feeling. He only begotten Son. You've been redeemed. You have been bought at a high price. And we have an incredible inheritance. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11 says, in Him we have obtained an inheritance. Back in April of this year, a firefighter from New Chicago, Indiana, went to the ATM to withdraw $200. That's a lot of money for a firefighter, isn't it, right? So he went to pull out $200. Whenever you go to the ATM, you get your money, and then you get your card, and then you get a little slip of paper. And the slip of paper tells you how much you withdrew, and then it also tells how much money you have left. And he looked at that paper, and it said $8.2 million. Now, this guy, being a firefighter, knows that he doesn't have $8.2 million. And so, being an honest man, the next day he called the bank. And he said, I went to the ATM. It says my balance is $8.2 million. And the person on the line looked at his account and said, you are right. You do not have $8.2 million. They said, sorry for the glitch, but that money was gone. Now, do you think if that $8.2 million would have actually been there, would he have been excited? We've been given so much more than that. Our inheritance from God far outweighs the money that man found in his account. In 1 Peter 1, 3 through 4, it says, according to his great mercy, the Father has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, and kept in heaven for you. We have a vast inheritance that's not going to go away overnight like that $8.2 million did. We have a vast inheritance that is imperishable. It's not going to be, it's not going to rot. It's undefiled. It's unfading because we are now children. We're now children of the King, and we belong to Him. I think Fanny Crosby must have been reading Ephesians whenever she wrote, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed by His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. I love that. I love that song. She understood that we are redeemed by Jesus, and now we're children forever because of the blood that Jesus shed on us. Well, God says, do I have a deal for you? That $8.2 million disappeared overnight. But what guarantee do we have saying that our inheritance from God, our salvation from God, what guarantee do we have that's not going to disappear overnight? Well, God says in Ephesians 1, 13 to 14, we're told that when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory. Whenever you believe, and whenever you were baptized into Christ, you receive a guarantee. You receive a guarantee. Acts 2, 38, 39 says it this way, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. A lot of times we stop right there, but listen to verse 39. For the promise, when God makes a promise, that's a guarantee. For the promise is for you and for your children and all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord God calls to Himself. Whenever you and I show up at heaven's gates, the Holy Spirit is a mark in us that we belong to Christ. I get to work the chain crew in the football game. And one of the things they're doing this year because of COVID, you have to have a field pass in order to enter that inner gate. You have to have a field pass in order to get on the field, so trying to limit the number of people. And when I show up with that badge that says field pass, they open the gates. They open it, and I go right in. Whenever we get to the gates of heaven, inside. The Holy Spirit. It's God's ownership. The Holy Spirit proves that we belong in heaven. Now, one last thing in Ephesians chapter 1, whenever you read through this, in verse 6, 12, and 14, you've got the phrase, to the praise of his glory. When this chapter tells us that something is to the praise of his glory, it means that it is a great honor for God to fulfill his promise to you. Whenever his promise is fulfilled to you, and you are redeemed, and you become a child of God, that is to his glory, and that is to his honor. He considered it a... that right now is together we stand.